Hi, my name is Peter Jochems, and on this channel, on this video channel, I talk about the painterly approaches of the 17th century Dutch artists, the old masters, according to ancient books that were written in those days about painting. When we talk about the art of painting, it is good to have a good definition, something to work from, of the art of painting. And in several of those books, there were definitions given about what painting is, what is the basic definition of the art of painting. This is what Samuel van Hoogstraten, a student of Rembrandt, wrote in his book published in 1678. This is what he wrote about the art of painting. The art of painting is a science to convey all ideas which the whole of visible nature can provide, to deceive the eye by means of outline and color. We are going to look at a painting by Johannes Vermeer, and it is called The Art of Painting, and it was already called The Art of Painting by his widow, so most probably he called it himself that way. Here we can see that Vermeer shows us a painter who is doing what Van Hoogstraten in essence says that the painter is doing. In chalk, he has put the outlines on the canvas. He is watching the model, and you could say he's watching the visible world around him. And now he methodically applies planes of color on the canvas. And it looks like that Vermeer wanted to show us the painter really at its essence, because the way that the painter is painting is actually not really in line with what we know about 17th century techniques. It looks like the painting technique has been modified to suit a certain angle in how to approach painting, and it's really using lines and coloring to create an image. And usually we would see an underpainting in brown colors if he would actually be painting in a typical 17th century way. When we look at the painting by Vermeer, one might perhaps wonder if this is a real depiction of how a painter worked that way. But the space in which the painter is painting is actually too clean. It's too expensive, the white and dark marble on the ground. I do not expect Vermeer to have had such an expensive floor. His clothing is too old-fashioned and too chic. And another funny thing is, when you look at the figure of the painter, just imagine that he would stand up. I think he would be twice as large, or really large, compared to the model. So you could say there is something strange going on with reality, but as Vermeer presents it, it is a convincing image. I want to show you another quotation by another writer. This is from Roger de Pauls, and he wrote, "The art of painting is an art which, by means of drawing and color on a surface, can imitate all visible things." These two quotations that I gave are very similar. One can wonder why would you give a second quotation which is almost the same as the first, but it's good to see the consistency of how they define the art of painting. The book by Samuel van Hoogstraten was called, when you translate it to English, Preface to the Higher Education of Painting, or The Visible World. It is really about depiction of what is visible. When Roger de Pauls gives his definition of the art of painting, he goes on about other subjects, because when you do paint something, there are other things that come into play, like composition, the disposition of objects in the pictorial space. You have light and dark, the clair-obscur, you have coloring, you have the expression of emotions. So in the text following that definition, Roger de Paals talks about several of these things, which are also important when you make a painting. In line with this, I want to show you an earlier book from 1637. Roger de Paals published his book early 18th century, by the end of the 17th century. He has written several books. Franciscus Junius was a philologist. I got that right in one time, that word. I'm not going to pronounce it again. But he wrote a book about quotations from antiquity that are about art. So especially the visual art, the art of painting. He wrote a book about that. And it's a very scholarly work. He collected, so to speak, all the things that were said in ancient literature about the art of painting. And he even changed certain quotations about, for example, poetry or the art of speaking. So he replaced the word poet by the word painter, for example, or the word artist. And Franciscus Junius, he mentions 5 points that a painter should take into account to create a good painting. And I want to talk about these points. He says, the ancients observed in picture these 5 principal points. Invention or historical argument. With this he means, for example, let's say the subject of a painting. So Christ going to Emmaus, for example, a biblical story or an allegory. Vermeer's The Art of Painting is an allegory. So all kinds of objects in that painting have a certain meaning. Proportion or symmetry. When you create a figure, there are proportions. How long are the arms? How long are the other parts of the body? So you can apply that to painted pictures, and I think you could apply that as well to objects. How are the dimensions of a closet or a table or something like that? But I think Junius mostly based this upon figures in a painting. Color and therein light and shadow, also brightness and darkness. Color, light and shadow. When you look at the art of painting again, you can see, for example, a careful placing of the brightest colors in the brightest light. You often see that. And they were careful to place colors in a painting. Where do you put a red chair? Oftentimes in the front of a painting, for example. Although that wasn't always the case. And light and dark. The use of lighting was something that the Dutch painters are famous for. So Gerard Tellares, for example, spends a lot of his time talking about all kinds of lighting situations in his book about painting. It was a very important subject for the Dutch painters. Motion or life, and therein action and passion. One could say, in short, the expression of emotions, or what is someone doing, or what does someone experience in the painting. When you look at the 100 guilder print by Rembrandt, Rembrandt once bought his own print at an auction for that amount of money to drive up the price, so he was a really commercial thinking painter. But when you look at that 100 guilder print, you see Jesus preaching. And Rembrandt really excelled in showing the effects of a certain instance on a person, the emotional effect. So when you look at the crowd, you can see almost the age. You can see how wealthy they are, even in the clothing. You can see their physical constitution. Are they healthy? Are they old? Are they frail? And you can see almost what the effect is of the sermon by Jesus on his crowd, on his audience. So that's what you could say is meant with life or motion or actions of passion. Disposition of an economical placing and ordering of the whole work. One could say that this is something very close to what we would call composition. So when you put objects into a piece, how do you place them against each other? Do you take, for example, 10 oranges? That would be boring, says, for example, Samuel van Hoogstraten. But you can use several kinds of fruits and carefully place them next to each other. Or, as Junius explains, when you paint a group of people, you can arrange the arms and legs in such a way that it does not become a chaotic scene, that there is some sort of harmony, that there are some parallels. Or when you look, for example, at the Night Watch by Rembrandt, and you look at the certain weapons that they have, the spears that they have, you can see that they are placed under a certain angle of 90 degrees when you compare them with each other. So that's a seemingly chaotic scene of a group of people going on a parade. But at the same time, he is very carefully arranging everything. And that is what is meant with disposition, the careful economical placing of things. Samuel van Hoogstraten mentions Franciscus Junius, the writer I was talking about, as actually the only person who did not paint himself, who wrote something worthwhile about the art of painting. The book that Franciscus Junius wrote is informative about painting, about antiquity, but it is written by a 17th century person, writer. And in a sense, in a way, when you carefully approach it, you can consider it also as a 17th century vision on art by means of selecting and carefully showing quotations from antiquity. So I find it a very interesting book, also because it echoes something which Roger de Pauls also wrote, but it's actually the other way around. Roger de Pauls was a later writer, but there's something similar in how they approach these things, mentioning several aspects, several points of painting that you have to take into account, that you have to carefully work out in the painting. What I find a very important remark by Franciscus Junius is what he says about these parts, these five parts, that these have to be treated well individually, but the real quality comes when all these five parts work together. So there's an extra quality to a painting when all these five parts are well executed and they come together in one painting. When you look at The Milkmaid by Vermeer, at first sight you would think that's a snapshot of a kitchen scene. But when you look closer, you see that the still life on the table is very carefully arranged. The lighting is very carefully put on there. And also look at her figure. It's very carefully chosen. The colors are carefully chosen, carefully lit. And when you look at the way that the eye moves from one part to the other, there's a certain build-up in intensity in light, for example. And when you look at the floor, there's a stove, and that stove also has a certain meaning. So you could say that the invention, or the first thing that Junius mentions, the subject of a painting, there is a certain iconography attached to the milkmaid, and you can look up in books what certain things mean, and that stove also has a certain meaning. So when you look at all the points that Junius mentions in his book, and you look at a painting like this, you can see that Vermeer works them out carefully in this piece, and these five parts combined, these points combined, give this painting in fact a certain completeness and a certain clarity, I would almost say, in vision. To recap this video, when we talk about the art of painting, according to 17th century sources, we talk about creating an image on a flat surface using outline and color to depict, to imitate something of the visible world around us. That's in essence what 17th century artists approached the art of painting. But as a sort of second layer, I would say, there are these five things that Junius mentions, like light and dark, coloring, the expression of emotions, the disposition or economical positioning of objects in a painting, etc. Proportion, I forgot to mention. So these things are important when you are painting like that, you know, when you are depicting images from the visible world on a flat surface, then those things come into play. I want to talk a little bit about the approach in these videos. Each video that I make, I try to let it stand on its own, and I try to create videos on all kinds of subjects relating to those five subjects, for example, that Junius gives. So when you follow these videos, you will sharpen your insights about all kinds of aspects of the art of painting. I consider what you are doing as a painter as a result of a system of views. You have a certain knowledge of something, a certain view on something. You develop a vision, which is built up on what you know and what you think about coloring, light and dark, all the things that I mentioned earlier in this video. These views, these are constantly in development. Rembrandt, when he was 50, he painted in a different way than when he was 20 or 30, because even when he was 50, for example, he remembered, I think, how he experimented at age 19 or 20. So you see him do things again when he was younger. And sometimes you do that as an artist. You think back of what you have done in the past, and you take certain things back which you found interesting but forgot about it perhaps, or you did things differently. But there's this constant development, and that's why you can watch a painting and see, well, this Vermeer wasn't painted in 1660 but 1668 or something. The planes are a bit smoother. He does something in this painting he didn't do before, whatever. So that kind of things that you can conclude by doing that, it's all part of the development of a painter in all kinds of ways. You can say in general there was of course, development as well. In 1650, they knew, for example, better how to treat reflected light and clair obscur than, let's say, the High Renaissance. Rembrandt knew better how to work with certain lighting effects than Raphael, but that's a development in time. The aim was pretty constant. That's why I mentioned those quotations about the essence of painting in defining, using outline and form, something of the visual world. The visible world on a flat surface. I mentioned quotations from Samuel van Hoogstraten from 1678, but Leon Battista Alberti in the 15th century said something similar already then. So the aim was quite similar and consistent. So there's a certain, with all kinds of sideways, there is a consistent line towards the height of, let's say, the Dutch old master painting, in which the sense of realism got more convincing in a painting. And that's how I approach these videos. I take certain insights from those books and I try to approach them in these videos, showing quotations and explaining them so we can reconstruct, in a sense, their insights on in all these subjects again to a certain extent, to the extent that it is possible to do. But now you have a sort of working definition. We have defined it in this video according to the old books that were written in those days, and we can work from there. Thank you for making it to the end of this quite long video, and I'll see you next time. Thank you.